What do you know?
What's going on?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. It's good to see you on what it's turning out to be a beautiful summer's day. It's gorgeous outside. I started the morning with a jacket on and realized I don't need a jacket today. This is perfect. So we'll see what happens. But the sun's out. It's a great day to be here. A couple of announcements. Our new Bible study ends tomorrow. It's the last of our three-part series on the parables, 10 o'clock in the church hall. We'll take a week off and then we'll come back for another Bible study after that. Sunday, June the 23rd at 2 p.m., Brock and Area Community Memorial Committee is having their annual memorial service and butterfly release at the fairgrounds. And you can see the information there if you want to take part. The ACW is having a card party on May the 9th at 1 p.m. Tickets are available from Cheryl. I think there might be other tickets around today. Bring your friends and you can win together. So, I don't want to say anyone in particular. Some people like to cheat. I don't know who they are, but anyway. And if you didn't know, congratulations to Ivan Fazzo, who got married this week on Wednesday. Congratulations. It was a great service here in the church, very intimate service, and so it was wonderful. So congratulations. And he's sleeping in this morning. Typical. And the ACW is having their monthly meeting this Thursday, which is actually May the 2nd, not the 3rd, at 1 p.m., and all leaders of the church are invited to attend. And there will be snacks and refreshments available. And for those of you in the hockey pool, you got your updates today. I must say, I wrote the hockey pool newsletter, and apparently Evelyn is insulted because it seems that I said that she cheated. I did not mean to imply that she cheated. I want to say it flat out, she cheated. There's no implication whatsoever. I'm just telling you right now, flat out. So. And go figure, she's in first place. So, anyway. I just want to be clear. There's no influence. Yes. Oh, Janet has an important announcement. Janice.
It's not that important. keep the date. Not in May, not in June, but July 13th, a Saturday, is our golf tournament and potluck. So, July 13th.
All right, so you can come and golf, or you don't have to golf, you can just come to the party afterwards, whichever you want. It's fine. Are there any other announcements? I'm missing anything? No? Okay, great. Our processional hymn, I did forget. Again, thank you, Carolyn, for filling in our music today. It's wonderful to have you here, as always, so thank you for sharing with us. And on a beautiful summer's day, you decided to be with us, so thank you so much.
It's a sacrifice.
It is a sacrifice, so you can tell me I'm here every week. It's a sacrifice. Our processional hymn is number 59 in your blue hymn books. Jesus calls us here to meet at number 59.
Thank you.
page 185, in the middle of the page. Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
May his grace and peace be with you.
May he fill our hearts with joy.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden.
Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Apostles, chapter 8, verses 26 through 40. It's entitled Philip and the Ethiopian Eunuch. Then an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go forward to the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of the Canaanite queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to this chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sorry.
No, you're,
yeah. It's 40, not 30.
Okay.
I had my eye fixed, not the other. Now the passage of the scripture that he was reading was this. Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer. So he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who could describe his generation? For this life was taken away from the earth. The eunuch said, ask Philip, about whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this, about himself or about someone else? Then Philip began to speak and started with this scripture. He proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, look, there is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized? He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. Then they came up out of the water. The Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch said to him no more, and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Don't feel bad, Sylvie. You know, I've read the wrong gospel sometimes. It's just the way it goes. I can't blame it on my eyes either, so it's just the way it is. Psalm appointed for this morning is the last part of Psalm 22. You can find it on page 730 in your green service books. Page 730. Psalm 22, we're doing verses 24 to 30. So 24 until the end. And we'll go back and forth. This side will do 24 and then 25, and we'll go back and forth. So we'll start with this side. My praise is of him in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. May your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations shall bow down before him. For a kingdom belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations. To him alone all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust fall before him. My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall be known as the Lord's forever. They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done. Father, your tortured son felt abandoned and cried out in anguish from the cross, yet you delivered him. He overcame the bonds of death and rose in triumph from the grave. Do not hide your face from those who cry out to you. Feed the hungry, strengthen the weak, and break the chains of the oppressed, that your people may rejoice in your saving deeds. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now the second reading.
The second reading is written in John's first letter in the fourth chapter, beginning at the seventh verse. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. and we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our gospel gospel hymn is 425 in your blue hymnals. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. We'll sing the first two verses before the gospel and verse 3 afterwards. Hymn 425. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So every family has their stories of things that are just by chance. And our family is not immune to that. So the story goes that one of Kim's uncles decided that he was going to leave England. And he just wanted to get out. And so what he said was, he said to his family, I'm going to go down to the docks. And I'm going to catch the first ship that leaves. And there were two ships at the dock that day, one going to Canada and one going to Australia. Lucky for us, the Australian one lost. And he came to Canada. Because he was here, his family followed. So just by chance, maybe by, I don't know, 5 minutes, an hour, 2 hours, instead of going to Australia, he came to Canada. How many times in our own lives have we met someone just by chance? Perhaps we were delayed at the airport, or maybe we were lined at the grocery store, or took a wrong turn somewhere, and that caused us to either be sooner to something or later to something, that caused us to meet someone who later became an important part of our lives. Maybe it's that you were looking for somewhere to go to live, and you drew a circle and said, anything within that radius, I can buy a house, and I can stay there, and I can live. And Beaverton just happened to be there, and there just happened to be a home that you wanted to buy. Just happened to be a place where you could afford, and you were satisfied with, and you could live. How many of us have those experiences? Maybe, go figure, you might have met someone at church who you might not have met otherwise, who later became a very good friend of yours. A support system, someone you could rely on. Maybe it's where you live, a neighbor who you never met before, came over that first day you moved in and welcomed you into the neighborhood, and you became fast friends and best friends later on. So many times in our lives we are presented with these opportunities that we never sought out and we probably never would have recognized, but God put us in that place so that we can benefit from those relationships and truly experience what it's like to just have that happenstance be created by God. In this story today that Sylvia read from the Acts, that's exactly what we see. Here we see this Ethiopian eunuch who just went up to Jerusalem and was just going back, minding his own business, doing what he had to do. There was not a big deal. And at the side of the road is Philip, and Philip receives a word, go and run after him and jump in. And so Philip did. And then God said, now start telling him about the scripture that he's reading. And Philip did. And eunuch, at that moment, his mind was open to the possibilities of Jesus and of God. The scripture, said Philip, is fulfilled this day, and you're hearing it. And so the eunuch says, wow. And then just by happenstance, there happens to be a well. And he says, what's to stop you from baptizing me right now? And Philip said, well, you have to go through all these steps, and the bishop has to make sure it's okay and all that. No, that's not what happened. What happened was he said, yes, let's go. Let's do it right now. All of those things had to fall into place in order for that to be fulfilled, in order for God's will to be fulfilled. And so it is with us. All of these chances that we have, all these opportunities that we have, are not by accident. God has given us these opportunities to meet someone we otherwise wouldn't have met, to stumble upon a situation otherwise we wouldn't have sought out, to minister to those who we might never have known had we not been there at that place at that time, not planning it, not expecting it, but still being willing to receive it. When Jesus talks about the vines and the vine growers and having all of that going on and fruit, what he's really talking about is the opportunity that we have, the opportunity to open ourselves to new things, to get rid of old things that are stopping us from bearing fruit, and instead look for those new things, those new opportunities that allow us to increase the kingdom of God. I mean, that's what Easter's all about, right? Increasing the kingdom of God. And so we're given these opportunities. And so, as always, we have the choice to accept them or to ignore them. Philip could have said, you know, he's going too fast. I don't really know him. I don't want to jump in. What if I'm disturbing his reading, right? All those things would have been okay, would have been valid. But he said, no, God's calling me here. I'm going to go there. And then Philip could have been intimidated to explain scripture, to open up the scripture, but he wasn't. And then he could have been intimidated when the eunuch said, "What's there to stop me from being baptized?" And Philip could have said, "I don't do that kind of stuff. They do it back in Jerusalem." But he didn't. And so it is for us. We're given these opportunities not to test us and not any of that, because we are given those opportunities to minister to others because we are faithful, because we love others, because we are able and willing to do what God wants us to do. It's not rocket science. It's not the most difficult thing, although it's not the easiest thing either. It does take a certain amount of fortitude. It takes a certain amount of guts. It takes a certain amount of faith to share what you know with others. It is not easy. It's not easy for me. It's not easy for any of us, because we're worried about what the reaction will be. But those opportunities still exist. And they exist so that we can share our faith, so that we can become whole in Jesus Christ, so that we can do what we're commanded to do, which is build up the kingdom of God. So what fruit is it that you are not bearing that you could? What branches can you trim to allow those that are bearing fruit to bear even more? How are you sharing the gospel to create the kingdom of God here? God will give you so many opportunities to share your faith, to share your story, and to share what you love. Let's grasp onto those opportunities. Let's be like Philip, and let's run after that cart and jump in and be ready to share the gospel to grow the kingdom of God in this place. Amen. Continue on page 189 with the Apostles' Creed. Will the congregation please stand? In your green books, page 189. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." Please turn with me to page 122 in your green service books. Litany number 15 for the season of Easter. Page 122. In joy and hope, let us pray to the source of all life, saying, "Hear us, Lord of glory." That our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter gospel, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he might provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That by his power, wars and famine may cease through all the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That he might reveal the light of his presence to the sick, the weak, and the dying. Remembering especially in our prayer list, Lily, Tom, Joe, Carol, Joan, Kayla, Bill, Jessica, Kenny, Gary, Paul, Janice, Brian, Alan, Laura, Jack, Emily, Scott, Marianne, Ab. We pray for all those living or working in long-term care facilities, all those hurt or displaced by the Hamas-Israeli conflict, the people of Ukraine, and for refugees from around the world.
In our Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Bangladesh, that they may be comforted and strengthened. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord, and glory.
That he might send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord, and glory.
And we continue on page 191 with the Confession and Absolution. Page 191. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting them to this holy table. Let us now confess our sins, confident in our Lord's eternal forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us now stand in the presence of our Lord as we exchange the peace with one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
of your truth. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. Service continues on page 198 in your green service books with Eucharistic prayer number 3. In your green service books, page 198, Eucharistic prayer number 3. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he destroyed death, and by his rising to life again he has won for us eternal life. Therefore, joining our voices with the whole company of heaven, we sing our joyful hymn of praise to proclaim the glory of your name. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ to make them new, and bring us to that city of light, where you dwell with all your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
We continue on page 211. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, page 213, fractional sentence number 8. Lord, we died with you on the cross. Now we are raised to new life. We were buried in your tomb.
now we share in your resurrection.
Live in us, that we may live in you. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Forward the altar rail to receive Holy Communion. If you wish a gluten-free wafer or your own individual cup, either for intinction or for drinking, please tell me at the rail as well.
Thank you.
congregation, please stand and pray. God of love, in this Eucharist we have heard your truth and shared in your life. May we always walk in your way. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And glory to God,
whose power really in us can infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in all the love of God and of the Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessed God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you this day and remain with you always.
Amen.
Our recessional hymn is 628 in your blue hymn books. O love, how deep, how broad, how high. Number 628.